Thank you very much, Dr. Ebert. And it was really a wonderful lecture on insulin resistance and the usage of thiazolidinones again in practice, which it had a setback in recent years, and again it's coming back into practice. So I think please stand by for question answers. Now we have the last speaker in this session. It's none other than one of our brilliant sons of India, that is Professor Shashank Joshi, and he is the chair of IDF Southeast Asia, president of the Indian Academy of Diabetes, and also former president of API, Endocrine Society of India, RSDI, and the All India Association of Advancing Research in Obesity. And he has been honored by the government of India by awarding him with Padma Shri in 2014 in recognition of his efforts to the cause of medicine. Dr. Shashank Joshi, please deliver the lecture. Welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Sadashiv Rao. And at the onset, I would like to thank Bansi for this wonderful meeting. My previous two speakers have made my job a little easy. I am supposed to usher what's happening in diabetes space as new advances in 2021. And Dr. Das started with the legacy, and Ebert very nicely has covered some of the current evidences, including the ACE. What I would probably do is give you the 2021 standards of medical care, which was published by the ADA, some overview of that, and something related to reversal and lifestyle. So we all know that the classification and diagnosis of diabetes essentially has remained the same. We know that type 1 diabetes, type 2 diabetes, they all are in the same bracket, so no major change. Only thing is that the LADA part of the diabetes, which is type 1.5 diabetes, currently goes into the type 1 diabetes completely. Criteria have pretty much remained the same, so no major changes. But when it comes to essentially the level of evidence and strength of recommendations for screening for pre-diabetes and type 2 diabetes, you can see that screening for pre-diabetes and type 2 diabetes should be there with informal assessment of risk factors or with valid tools in asymptomatic adults. The level of evidence and strength of recommendation is B. We first test pre-diabetes or type 2 diabetes in asymptomatic people at any age if they are overweight or obese with a BMI more than 23 in Asians and who have one or more additional risk factors. Strength of recommendation, level of evidence B. And testing for pre-diabetes or type 2 diabetes should be considered in women with overweight or obesity planning pregnancy with one or more additional risk factors for diabetes, level of evidence C. So obviously, these are the criteria for testing, and these have gone through some granularity of change. And of course, criteria for pre-diabetes has pretty much remained the same. Fasting 100 to 125 IFG, 2 hours, 75 gram glucose between 140, 190 IGT, and A1C between 5.7 to 6.4. GDM criteria again have remained pretty much the same, whether it is testing, level of evidence is B for the standard first prenatal visit, screen and test, 24th to 20th week of gestation who don't have diabetes, level evidence for A, and B level of evidence that test for pre-diabetes or diabetes 4 to 12 weeks postpartum with a 75 gram glucose load, level of evidence B. And the standard Kuston counter criteria are still, Carpenter-Kuston criteria are still there, 95, 180, 155, 140, and very clearly they are there. The other focus has been prevention or delay of type 2 diabetes. And we know that the overall recommendation is to do annual monitoring for development of type 2 diabetes in those in pre-diabetes, but the level of evidence there is poor at E. Lifestyle or behavioral change for diabetes prevention, usually based on the diabetes prevention program. So refer somebody. So there is a clear-cut referral here. Level of evidence A, refer a patient with pre-diabetes to intensive lifestyle behavioral change program modeled to prevent diabetes, the diabetes prevent on program to achieve an A1C of 7% loss of weight and increase physical activity to moderate to intensity at least for 150 minutes per week. So this is a level A evidence, and that's what I'm going to talk, that if you integrate them into a program which can do that, it can make a lot of difference. The second thing which has been highlighted here is a variety of eating patterns can be considered to prevent diabetes in individuals with pre-diabetes, level of evidence B. Continuing the lifestyle behavior change for pre-diabetes prevention, based on patient preference, they have actually allowed certified technology-assisted diabetes prevention programs to be effective in preventing type 2 diabetes and should be considered. And I'll show you a technology-assisted program a little later with level of evidence B. Given the cost-effectiveness of lifestyle behavior intervention programs in diabetes prevention, where the level of evidence is A, such diabetes prevention programs should be covered by reimbursement, level of evidence B. Metformin, of course, still stands out. And particularly if the BMI is above 35, age above 60, and women with pre-GDM, clearly metformin is there. Level of evidence is A for metformin. Despite of all the hoopla around SGLT2 inhibitors, metformin still has a level of evidence, particularly if you have BMI above 35, age more than 60, or women with pre-GDM. But metformin is a level of evidence B, and do a B12, particularly in those who have anemia or peripheral neuropathy. Then obviously, comprehensive medical evaluation and assessment of pre-morbidities. The goals of CASE have pretty much remained the same. They have continued the same circle of care with the SMART management plan of specific, measurable, achievable, realistic, and time-related plan. And obviously, if you look at the various histories, including diabetic history, family history, personal history, interval history, behavioral factors, medications, and vaccinations, which are now going to be very popular in the post-COVID era. And technology use has come as a big thing now. They assess the use of health apps, online education, patient portals, use glucose monitoring techniques and use that data in a more meaningful way. And of course, pumps and setting for use. The other thing which is important now in diabetes is not just behavior, not just medicines and vaccinations, not just technology, but social life assessment. So look at social support, look at identify the surrogate decision maker and advanced care plan, because often we see that maybe the patient living, person living with diabetes may not be the primary decision maker, and identify social determinants of health like food security, housing stability, homelessness, transport access, financial security, and community safety. Physical examination is still the key. So are the labs, and labs evaluation including one liver function test. MNT still has a very high level of evidence. Sending them to a good RD works, whether it's type 1, type 2, pre-diabetes or GDM. The diabetes medical nutrition therapy is cost effective. Level of evidence B. Outcome oriented for A1C, weight loss and decreased lipids, A, and obviously should be reimbursed. And the energy content must come down. And weight loss is recommended, level of evidence A. Eating patterns need modulation. Distribute the calories with carb, fats and proteins, the macro plans. Then we go to the eating patterns. And then each of them needs some modulation, whether it is the carbs, whether it's overall carbs coming down, whether it's with flexible insulin therapy, whether it's fixed dose insulin therapy, and obviously to replace sugar-sweetened beverages with the sweeteners. Proteins need to be up. Dietary fat needs to be modulated. Micronutrients and herbs have a role, including you can see aloe vera, cinnamon, chromium, vitamin D coming in the ADA guidelines, though the dietary supplementation does not have any level of evidence. So clearly you can see that there is very clear granularity. Alcohol has a big space there. Adults with diabetes who drink alcohol should do so in moderation, not more than one drink in adult women and more than two drinks in adult men. And the level of evidence is C. And clearly look and watch out for hypoglycemia. Sodium consumption needs to be restricted. Non-nutritive sweeteners are there. Glycemic targets of A1C more than twice a year. Level of evidence E, and otherwise recently who don't meet goals. Individualized targets still remain. Hypoclassification level 1. 70 to 54, level 2, less than 54, level 3, serious event where mental or physical status is altered. Obesity again has a lot of emphasis on a drastic weight loss and level A evidence for reduction and high frequency counseling, more than 16 sessions over 6 months. So that's really the key which is there in the modern plans of weight loss with diabetes. And you can see that motivation, lifestyle, circumstances, behavior is a big thing. And so is the short term. VLCD, which is the direct trial diet for reversal in carefully selected patients with trained practitioners with lot of close monitoring, can lead to actually even reversal of diabetes. So clearly you can see that obesity in diabetes also has pharmacotherapy, and they can have the levels of evidence, and all the obesity medications are there. And when it comes to pharmacological therapy, the ADA is very clear. Metformin is still level A evidence. If it is not tolerated, not contraindicated, including insulin, can be added. Early combination has been given level A preference. And insulin should be used if there is catabolism, if there is A1C about 10% or glucose about 300. So clearly you can see a need for insulin coming up earlier. It's all patient-centric, where cardiorenal choices, hypoglycemia, impact of weight, cost, risk side effects, patient preferences go up right up the order. And in that pecking order, as Abbott said, SGLT2 inhibitors or GLP-1 receptor agents have gone up the pecking order there. So this is how all the agents look like. I don't want to go into that because I'm sure all of you all will discuss that during the meeting. And of course, cardiovascular risk assessment. Don't forget your blood pressure target. Don't forget your atherosclerotic vascular risk target. And they all have level A evidence. So clearly, you know, you can see that if you treat glucose aggressively, treat blood pressure equally aggressively and try to treat it to a goal, particularly with ACE or ARB as a first line, particularly in patients which are there, and then add more agents. So clear cut directions on antihypertensive agents. In fact, they have a very nice graph on antihypertensive agents with confirmed hypertension. Step one, step two, you know, less than 160 over 100, but above 140, 90, start a single agent. If there's albuminuria or coronary artery disease, start with ACE and ARB. If there is no albuminuria or coronary artery disease, you can pretty much start diuretic, calcium channel blocker, ACE or ARB. If, however, the initial blood pressure is 160 or 100, start with two agents. If there's albuminuria or CAD, it's ACE or ARB with a CCB or a diuretic. Otherwise, take two out of three options. Clearly, blood pressure recommendations have got more and more aggressive, and we can see more and more of them. There's also an algorithm which is added in the new guidelines, which is for new onset diabetes in the youth with overweight and obesity. So if somebody is young patient, walks in with overweight and obesity, look for acidosis, DK or HHNK, then start them on insulin right away and screen them for pancreatic autoantibodies. All young patients with new onset should be screened for pancreatic autoantibodies and C-peptide. If the A1C is more than 8.5 and there is no acidosis, with or without ketosis, you can still look at metformin or basal insulin. And if it is less than 8.5, no acidosis, no ketosis, then only you look at metformin as an option. Pregnancy and diabetes, again, glycemic targets are better oriented, and we all know the targets very well, and lifestyle is the first. So I think I'll stop there as far as the ADA criteria are concerned and give you the next 5 minutes on where are we headed in diabetes today in 2021. We are all going to see something called as DBCD. Whatever we see today in the metabolic space is dysglycemia-based chronic disease, which means that dysglycemia is equal to insulin resistance, pre-diabetes and type 2 diabetes. And clearly, when we say that, the first stage of DBCD is molecular. It is insulin resistance. And here you can do primordial or primary prevention. The second stage is biochemical, where there's a cardiometabolic risk. 2A is low risk, 2B is high risk. It's primary and secondary prevention. It's the pre-diabetes phase. Stage 3 is biochemical disease, where we can do secondary and tertiary prevention. And it's basically overt type 2 diabetes. Okay. And stage 4 is vascular complications, mild, moderate, and severe, where we can do tertiary complications. And we can also have another term there, which comes up, which is CMBCD or IR, which is very useful. That is obesity, insulin resistance, metabolic syndrome, and type 2 diabetes and cardiovascular disease with complications. So clearly we now know that based on the staging of the disease, whether it is DBCD or ABCD, it is at risk, pre-disease, disease, and complications. And we need to intervene at each of these stages with lifestyle. So can we integrate lifestyle, medicine? Can we use computers? Can we use artificial intelligence? Yes, you can actually create a digital twin. You can learn it by computer. Look at signals of health, look at signals of emotions and happiness, and look at treatment issues and devise a reversal of chronic disease program with precision nutrition, sleep, activity, medicine, and insights. And actually, if you use some of these programs, you can actually reverse this disease. It's a twin health program. Dr. Bansi Sabu uses this very aggressively, where you can reverse diabetes, hypertension, dyslipidemia, obesity, kidney disease, liver, pancreatic beta cells, and so on and so forth, including inflammation. What does it do? It uses CGM and predicts the food metabolic response, which is unique for each patient, and tries to give you a pattern recognition which improves over time. It not only just looks at food, but it looks at what food, what meal, what combo, how often, and gives a suggestion how to accurately predict the taste preferences, which food to do. So what it does is it has sensors around an individual, which is guided by a coach under supervision of a doctor, where you have a CGM, blood pressure 24 hours, ketone body, body scale, Fitbit, all the blood works are done, the food activity is plotted, the heart markers are plotted, the muscle mass and the lean body mass and the fat mass, sleep, all of them is calculated, and nutrition is broken down into macro, micro, and even the gut microbiota. And all this through continuous machine learning, they are recognizing, the computer and big data is recognizing what that particular human being has, and then giving signals to the coach that what changes should be made, so that the advice to nutrition is precise in terms of macronutrient, in terms of micronutrients, in terms of gut microbiota, sleep, as well as the need for less medicines and insights of emotional health and happiness. So obviously you can really create various tools which we have now, which we can use very effectively, whether it's CGM, blood pressure monitor, ketone monitor, smart scale, Fitbit, Apple Watch, and an app, and use these sensory readings to actually get into a precision-based, you know, diabetes treatment, where we pick up sensor readings, member logs, blood reports, and use artificial intelligence and machine learning and adapt to the nutritional databases and medicinal databases to get an individually curated nutrition, medicine, and lifestyle plan. And that's going to be the next future. It's digital diabetes care. But nothing can substitute prevention. You know, we need to still eat less, eat on time, eat in the morning, eat right, walk more, sleep well, and sleep on time, and smile. So obviously, my only message again today to you is we are entering 2021 with new normal, in a digital normal. We need to do digital detox, but we can use a lot of digitalization to manage diabetes. We are in an era of digital diabetes care. We have a lot of new guidelines which are highly evidence-based, like the ADA 2021 guideline. And I hope what you listened, you will learn, what you learned, you will adapt, and you will sleep well today. And a happy 2021 to everybody. Thank you.